want to start with a short story and kind of the question. So the short story will be of two pictures, and the big question is, what is the difference and what are the differences and similarities between these two pictures? So it's a kind of a quiz. Mm-hmm. This is the first picture. And that's the second. So what are the differences and similarities between these two pictures? If we take this as we do usually, we see, first we start to identify objects, like a person and a rope, and then we try to think how do these objects relate to each other. So like a person relates to a rope in kind of interesting ways. And so the question is, do we miss anything with this analysis or not? I think that we miss something that's unpredictable, risk, challenge, and yeah, unpredictability of the situation, which is not encoded in these ropes and persons. So, in this presentation, I will try to sort of address and analyze this hidden play of the social systems, and more specifically of the global society. And yes, as I already said, so everyone knows, this presentation is available online, and these are little feathers on some of the slides. So if you click on them, you may find some interesting comments and sort of elaborations of certain slides, and actually comment them yourself, which would be very nice, just to know. And this is a collaborative work. This presentation is a collaborative work by me, who is Viktoras, and Weaver, who is David. And we are researchers at the Global Brain Institute and also PhD students at Brie Universität Bruxelles. Please tell me if I pronounce it incorrectly. And in this presentation, I will talk about what we think about the current situation of the global society in terms of the image of world of youth. And then I will introduce the concept of living cognitive society as a kind of process view of, not a kind of, but process view of global society. And then I will apply this concept to try to explain the disruptive impact of the information and communication technologies on our global society, something that a lot of people in this conference call the crisis of information society. Okay. So the current situation. It seems that our times can be sort of characterized with this overwhelming feeling that all something is not stable anymore, and everything is changing, and we don't understand anything. And we think that this the source of this feeling is exactly what I showed in the story, is that we try to understand all the situations by looking at the stable at the objects and their relationships, but what we struggle to grasp is the change itself without referring to objects and relationships between the objects. So we are used to think of society in terms of picture on the right, but it seems that society is more like the picture on the left, which creates the impression that we cannot, well, our models are failing us. We cannot predict what's happening with the society. And hierarchy or stable states and this fluidity, they are partial representations of the system of society. Therefore, they are partially true. So we see hierarchies and stable states in the society because first they are really there, and second is because we are, our brains are wired to see stable patterns in messy data. But we also see the flowing dynamics of the system. And we argue that approaching the system, first of all, as fluid, and only then seeing stable states as kind of islands in this fluidity is superior than our usual way. Because when the system changes fast, we do not really see any stability in it. So we cannot see transition between stable states or objects. But we still construct our, we still think and construct our governance systems in terms of these stable states or stable variables. And it's clearly not adequate, but is it possible to think of our systems in any, to make sense of our systems in any other way? And yeah, so we come back to this question. And to, one way to, in order to try to answer this question is good to look at how do we make sense in general of everything. And we single out three interrelated aspects of sense making. And we always use all three of them, but the difference is which one do we emphasize depending on the situation or depending on the system we are analyzing. So the first aspect is what we call factual necessity, which are sort of objective actualities of the system. For example, in let's say in physics or chemistry, no matter how much we want something to happen, whatever happens, it happens because there are certain natural laws, and these happenings follow natural laws. The second perspective, it highlights the observer projections and points of views to the system. So in natural sciences, these observer projections are regarded as researcher biases, which is something that we try to avoid at all costs because this is not good for the research. But in social systems, the situation is completely different and, let's say, more interesting, because the values of participants of the system, they are part of the system itself, so we cannot analyze the system without including the values of participants into the analysis. And even more nicely, we are participants, which means analysis itself kind of influences how the system behaves and what we do with it. And finally, we can pragmatically combine the two previous perspectives without searching for some sort of higher truth or objective, unified theory of everything. And yeah, in other words, we can just approach every local situation or local problems with local solutions and using local views, whether they are biased, stupid, partial, or like dangerous. Just whatever works for certain goals. So in our attempt to model sociodynamics, we make certain explicit attempt to explicate our values towards it. And whatever combination of perspectives we use, this leads to a worldview. And the outcome of sense-making process is a worldview. And what is a worldview? A worldview is a gestalt perception, unique and integrated cognitive structure, whether it's held by collective or individual, towards self, others, the world, society, universe, and whatever we are thinking about. And as such, it includes our aspirations towards, for example, exploration, growth and development, or maybe stability and safety. Also, our tendencies and possibilities, such as survival, abundance, or dystopia, depending on taste, probably. Also, our approaches to governance, in terms of whether we envision domination of individual states, world government, or distributed governance. Social systems, as I introduced, they have what we call a high degree of coupling between participants of the system and the system itself, and the global behavior. Therefore, the values of participants, they depend on these worldviews. So therefore, worldviews, we see worldviews as a main component, or most important factor of the sort of which influences the global behavior of the social system. And this is what we call the, actually it's not we call it, but this is what's called the property of reflexivity of social system. And this reflexivity refers exactly to this property, that elements of a system, interaction between elements of a system, it creates the global behavior of the system, and then this global behavior of the system influences the behavior of elements, and then these elements again influence the behavior of the global system. And then we have kind of an eternal loop which determines where we are going. For example, let's say a simple example. When two people meet, they do not even know whether they are friends or enemies. And if, let's say, one person starts to gently smile, the probability that another person will smile back because he thinks that the person is friendly. But if one person just, for some reason, frowns, maybe didn't have nice lunch, the probability is that another person will frown back and they will have an unfriendly meeting or encounter. So, objectively speaking, are they friends or enemies? Another question asked, were they friends or enemies before they met? And in social systems, the same dynamics which is illustrated by these two people actually happens not only between individuals, but also between different scales in social systems, which means individuals and families, or individuals and companies, or businesses, maybe states, communities, schools of thought, and or things like that. So, we can ask the question, whether is the world or universe at large is a friendly place or not friendly place, or unfriendly place. And we think that it's important question, sort of, and worthy to ask ourselves, especially before we try to re-engage in the activity of predicting what is going to happen with our future global society. Okay, so we propose a concept of living cognitive society as a way of thinking of our aspiration, projections, and possibilities of global information society, and how they emerge from the interaction of individuals or companies, families, and how they influence back ourselves. We explain the concept of living cognitive society in terms of its structure as an image of a world of use, in terms of its dynamic, with the help of a concept of synthetic cognitive development, and then coupling between structure and dynamics. So, in terms of structure, the global society is a complex system consisting of interacting subsystems at different scales. For example, individuals, families, companies, businesses, communities, cities, and nation states or countries. And if we abstract from if we abstract from these examples, we can clearly see the scalable nature of a social system. That is, individuals are generic cognitive agents which interact together, and they form communities, families, or businesses, which interact together and form markets, systems, and countries, nation states, and all of this form a global society. Yeah. And we propose to see this system not as sort of as a scalable system which emphasizes the fluidity of the system instead of the hierarchies of which we can find there. Of course, we can find several hierarchies in the system. And by taking this view, we can see that every subsystem is a element in a larger subsystem, but it also is made of smaller scale elements on the, say, smaller scale. And a hierarchy may partially explain this structure, but what we are interested in is change, and we think that we need certain another approach to explain change. Now, if we substitute these subsystems in this world of use structure, we actually get a partial representation of what we mean by the digital world of use, which illustrates our point that the social subsystems are embodiments of world views, and they operate as cognitive agents, having their own values, knowledge, styles of behavior, and goals. By taking this perspective, we can start to understand social systems not as not just only as interaction in one scale between, let's say, persons, but also as interactions between different scales, like these persons with families, persons with nation states, or all kind of communities with, let's say, global society. So, a world of use is our image of an entity also called the global brain. What we emphasize with this image is fluidity or ecological view to the society without any locus of control. Because even the brain can be understood as an ecology of interacting neurons, areas, activation patterns which go to the interaction of thoughts. Of course, we do not negate that there is a very strong coordination aspect in our cognitive system, which can be found there too. So, this was the structure of a living cognitive society as interacting embodiments of worldviews at multiple scales. Dynamics within this ecology is based on the processes of interaction and of integration and disintegration. So integration is, Francis explained it in a much more probably elaborate way, is when the components are coordinated in some manner, which we call integrated system or coupled system, and we call the system disintegrated or decoupled when the components are just not coordinated in any manner in the behavior. It's important that systems are never fully integrated and fully disintegrated, so they are always somewhere in between. Therefore, it makes much more sense to talk about the degree of integration rather than this binary state of being integrated or disintegrated. And furthermore, the integration and disintegration, it happens between, in a scalable manner, or between scales. Therefore, we can select a certain focal scale and to see the agents emerging in this scale in terms of interaction between scales above and scales below. And in case of disintegration, we cannot really see any agent in the focal scale, which alters both scale above and scale below, therefore the whole system. Which leads us to this concept that the living cognitive society is emerges from the interplay between internal and external relations of its own subsystems. That is, relations of interiority, which are relations between these lower scale elements within the boundaries of the subsystem, and relations of exteriority, which are relations of the system, of the elements within the boundary with the elements outside the boundary of the system. Which furthermore leads to a concept of cognitive development, and we define generic cognitive development as an ongoing balancing of internal and external relations and interactions across the emerging boundary of an individual towards increasing cognitive complexity. Which explains the emergence of a cognitive agent between two scales. The balancing interplay of these internal and external relations, it implies periods of integration and disintegration which alternate between each other. And this is exactly what is conveyed by the concept of cognitive development. And these periods are called stages of development. So we call the whole process synthetic cognitive development, and we argue that this is a generic process of open-ended intelligent expansion. And it applies not only to humans, but also to any cognitive agents, including the global society or global, what was that, living cognitive system as a cognitive agent. So we had two aspects, structure and dynamics. And now what we want to see is how structure relates to dynamics. The coupling between structure and dynamics happens via the process of transduction, which is maybe the most significant aspect of theory of individuation by Gilles Verve, Simon Bon. And for the purposes of this presentation, I will just introduce two aspects of transduction. The first aspect is metastability, which originates in the complex system dynamics. The good example of metastability is stock markets, where expectations of traders, they basically influence the global behavior of markets very much. And they play a major role there. Classically, metastability is defined as a phenomenon when a system is permanently in a configuration other than the system's state of least energy. Yet there is another important aspect which we would like to emphasize, is that in the metastable system, the states of least energy, which are basically basins of attraction in the energy landscape of the system, they are not stable themselves. Therefore, we can say that the energy landscape of the system is in permanent flux. Additionally to the fact that the system is always not in the attractor, in any attractor of the system. The coupling of structure and dynamics in a metastable system happens via the process of progressive determination, which describes two things. The first is it describes how every structure depends on the previous operation, and every operation depends on the previous structure. So the whole dynamics of the system depends basically on the whole history of the system since the beginning of time. And second, it describes the deeply rooted unpredictability of what will happen with the system. Therefore, we do not know in advance whether in terms of subsystems, whether they will integrate or disintegrate at a certain point of time. Okay, so we looked at the current situation of the cognitive Current situation and a concept of living in cognitive society. Now I would like to propose how does it help us to understand the disruptive impact of the information and communication technologies on the global society. So the disruptive, we think that disruptive impact of the ICT happens via, again, three mechanisms. One is the accelerating interaction among the worldviews in this global society. Another is diversification and multiplication of the embodiments of the worldviews in the global social system, which results in the fluid identity of the society. The more dynamic interaction between worldviews happens via what we call the factors, the three factors of social complexity. The first is reflexivity, which I already explained, which basically explains how different scales of the system interact in a circular manner. Also, another factor is the hyperconnectivity, which refers to the fact that every agent and every event in the system is progressively more and more connected to other events and agents within the same system. Which leads to an accelerating change due to an explosive multiplication of worldviews and information traveling between them and their communication. Of course, it inhibits our ability to predict or model the system behavior and again adds to this feeling that, oh, we don't understand anything more. The feeling of crisis. The second mechanism of the disruptive impact is diversification. Because ICT amplifies the creation of virtual identities as embodiments of worldviews, which do not have one-to-one relationship to the physical identity of us people, to any physical identities. And I would like to give a few examples in order to convince you, Francis, you too, that this is not some sort of nerdish idea from taken from science fiction movies, and actually it's not really directly related to ICT as we know it. So the first one is Dame Agatha Mary Clarissa Christie Bonas Miller, who wrote 66 detective novels and 14 short stories as Agatha Christie, and we all know her. But she also, that's a question, whether she or not. This person also wrote 6 romances under the name of Mary Westmacott. Nicolas Bourbaki, or Bourbaki, sometimes is called the greatest mathematician who never existed. And this is a group of 20th century mathematicians, which published a series of highly influential mathematical books under the collective pseudonym of Nicolas Bourbaki. And from the perspective of a global society, these are very well-defined and integrated individualities, just like me and you, or maybe a little bit more integrated than me and you. Now, corporations can be seen as artificial personalities too, and they are defined as non-human entities which are created by the law with their own rights and duties. Now, in the internet age, we have Wikipedia, which is an example how a trusted source of information can be created without any trusted individuals which are doing this. So this can be understood as a distinct individuality, distinct from the people who are creating it. Satoshi Nakamoto is a person or group of people who created Bitcoin protocol and a reference software for using it, which we do not really know whether they really exist. This is a real legal person We do not know whether it's they, she, he, it, or just computer, maybe program. But still, we do not, do we really care in terms of what kind of influence this email address had on the internet ecology as we see it? And actually, it's not a very huge jump in the imagination to imagine semi-autonomous computer programs which can be a government institution or businesses with little human involvement, which is called distributed autonomous organizations. So the dynamic interaction among diverse worldviews or diverse embodiments of worldviews, it results in a system of high degree of viscosity or fluidity. Therefore, we think we envision the global society as having a fluid identity, or maybe more exactly as being a fluid process. Emerging from this ecology of interacting diverse embodiments of worldviews. And this identity will reflexively shape the worldviews that we are embodying ourselves. Information technology will be is a great amplifier of this fluid process of living cognitive society, but it will not determine the direction of how the dynamics of the society. What will determine this direction of the dynamics is what's called the modes of social inscription of technologies, which are exactly embodiments of worldviews, or the worldviews. Because as we all know, the technology can be used for total control and also for facilitating total freedom of expression. And the good example, maybe the best example, is National Security Agency versus Edward Snowden. Because they use the same technology. The image of the fluid identity of society raises an important question of how we can govern such a system, which looks like a little bit chaotic. And I will tell only principles of distributed social governance. The principle is that we think that distributed social governance will need to think not about the structures or hierarchies of how society should be governed, but rather as optimal processes allowing for structures or hierarchies to mesh whenever they are needed to do certain work depending on the certain situation. And probably this will be the next talk, not today. Thank you.
So, any questions?
I apologize in advance, but when we were...
Good that you said.
Okay. But when we were at dinner a few nights ago, I said, I hope the universe is a friendly place. And I sort of said, that's my faith. You know, the universe is a friendly place, and maybe the end of history will be, you know, utopia, not dystopia. Well, in your slide, you said, that's the most fundamental question, quoting Einstein. But at dinner, you told me, I disagree with you. I think the universe is a very dark place. So I want your opinion on that first. That's, and then my second question is, to be fair to the humanities people, because I've been hard on them as well, which is, to what extent does high theory shoot itself in the foot? And basically the question I'm getting at is, what very simply Could you explain to me very simply what we understand from this model in terms of what we should do to facilitate common cognitive development in the future?
So the first was that you, I said that universe is not a friendly place.
That's unfortunate.
First of all, that was 3 days ago.
Okay, so now you've changed your mind, universe is a friendly place now, like, come on.
Agatha Christie had kind of two personalities. One is criminal kind of stories, another is romances. What's wrong with that?
It was
your
dinner personality.
Yeah, dinner personality and the presentation personality. The serious answer would be that I act and I do things and I sort of try to frame my thinking as if the universe is a friendly place. With this idea, of course, I'm not megalomaniac. If this is a correct word, I don't think that the way I think will influence the whole universe. But still.
Okay, that was
so I act as if it's friendly. I understand that there are kind of unfriendly elements.
Okay, that was mostly a joke, but what I seriously and just genuinely want to know is, from this model of synthetic cognitive development, living society and worldviews, just very simply, because we live in a political world. What very simply from this model do we learn about facilitating common cognitive development?
Diversity. The more diversity, the better. And a lot of times, or quite a few times I've heard here, that the world is in crisis. We have to deal with the crisis somehow, which implies that there is some sort of understanding that, okay, the crisis, We have to do something in order for this period to end, and then we will have a happy and stable and nice life, and it won't be crisis anymore. Because everything will be understandable. So my approach is, this crisis is eternal. We have to learn living with this diversity of unpredictability of what will happen next day or...
But diversity isn't the crisis. The crisis is monoculture.
Pardon?
The crisis isn't diversity, the crisis is monoculture.
Oh, so the short answer to your question is diversity and multiplication of whatever world is. We shouldn't repress any kind of thinking or worldview or style of behavior.